everyone. Welcome back to Today in Tech. I'm Juliet Beauchamp. I am here with Network World senior writer Jon Gold. And today we're going to be talking about Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 6E. So stick around. All right, Jon, thank you so much for calling in. So Wi-Fi 6, we know maybe a little bit about, but I want to talk about first what Wi-Fi 6 is and why Wi-Fi 5 wasn't good enough.
Well, I mean, the short answer is, when is any of this stuff good enough? You know, tech's about iterating and improving and all that sort of thing. Wi-Fi 6 is such a big deal, largely because it's just, you know, it's probably the biggest evolution of, you know, the basic Wi-Fi standard in a long time. It's the way it handles, you know, it has two technologies in it that are particularly, they're called OFDMA and MU-MIMO. I can probably remember, it's orthogonal frequency division multiple access, which I'm going to pretend I remembered off the top of my head. But in essence, what these are just clever ways to help subdivide, you know, the amounts of spectrum that Wi-Fi is using to send information back and forth. And it's just with the upshot being that it's just a lot more efficient and, you know, a lot better able to handle really dense deployments of devices.
So can we also talk a little bit about what the first acronym that you mentioned, the multi-user MIMO, because that's also a pretty big deal and a slight upgrade from Wi-Fi 5, right?
Yes. MIMO technology is multiple input, multiple output. Single-user MIMO is just the ability to use multiple antennas at one end of the device to, at one end of a circuit to send information to somebody else. Multi-user MIMO is, you know, the ability to use all those different antennae to, you know, make a bunch of different connections. So, you know, it's just that much more able to, you know, again, have one access point being incredibly able to deal with like a lot of connections at the same time.
Great. So the short answer of why Wi-Fi 6 is such an upgrade from Wi-Fi 5 and why it's perhaps more desirable than Wi-Fi 5 is basically more efficient, more channels.
Speed and density, basically. Yeah, that's about right.
Okay, so it's obviously a really appealing solution. And I know I talked about this maybe a week or so ago when I did a video with Jack Gold, who is not you. and we talked
a
little
bit. I get confused all the time.
So we talked a little bit about how everyone's working from home now, and everyone's also relying, therefore, on their home networks, which in some cases maybe is enough. Maybe someone is really into getting, you know, the top of the line, highest speeds that their ISP offers, and maybe some people are still working off of their Wi-Fi networks or routers that are years and years old. I mean, it's potential that they're still working off of Wi-Fi 4, right? So
sure.
Something that we talked about is the appeal of Wi-Fi 6 for, I mean, potential employers to have their employees, their remote employees, upgrade to Wi-Fi 6. How easy is that transition right now for just, you know, your layperson Wi-Fi user?
Oh, I mean, just if you're talking about upgrading remote workers to that sort of to the new standard, yeah, it's pretty easy. You just need to buy them a new router and they can plug it in if they're able to do that. I would imagine most remote workers can handle it. So it's quite easy. And that's a really good way. I think the only issue is that with home connections, a lot of the time, what's going to happen is that Wi-Fi 6 is going to be just almost like too much capacity in and of itself. Like you're still going to be bottlenecked by however fast your home internet connection, you know, is to begin with. So I wonder how much it will help, but you know, it is, you know, better, newer technology. It certainly couldn't hurt.
And I think another big caveat, and I talk about this so much, especially in regards to 5G. I mean, with 5G, it seems like it's, you know, that hype wireless technology of the moment. But if you don't have a wireless device that is equipped with 5G capabilities, you can't really benefit from these 5G networks. Is that similar for Wi-Fi 6?
It was until fairly recently, but we've actually got Wi-Fi 6 capable endpoints on the market now. Some of the latest laptops, latest flagship phones from like Apple and Samsung all have it, I believe. So we're hitting that inflection point where it's going to start being, you know, sort of the common standard for everything.
So let's shift gears a little bit now and talk about Wi-Fi 6E, which, so how is that different from Wi-Fi 6? I feel like that's the most important question right now.
Well, broadly, what happened was, this is, a new technology. The wireless industry has been angling for this for a long time. The FCC recently just made a big decision that opens a huge amount of spectrum in the 6 gigahertz range, which again, they've been after for a long time to, so this is, I believe I was reading that it's something like 4 or 5 times as much spectrum as all Wi-Fi in general has had in the past. So this is, just an enormous amount of new bandwidth for them to play with. Wi-Fi 6E will let you use just huge channels and lots of them at once to send data around. So again, the advantages are going to be, faster speeds and a better ability to handle multiple connections. So it's just, a big improvement over the top.
What's a real world scenario that maybe our viewers can look at to better understand how Wi-Fi 6E is different than Wi-Fi 6 and even Wi-Fi 5?
Well, I don't know what a real world scenario would look like, but I guess just the thing to remember is that it's, it's like Wi-Fi, but, with, a huge amount of extra capacity, access to these airwaves that they haven't had access to before. They're very excited. I've got, there's been a lot of celebrating in my inbox from wireless equipment makers lately. They're very pleased. And the interesting thing is it was actually done, partially over the objections of, other sort of stakeholders. There's been, licensed use of the 6 gigahertz band for a long time. And it's, I believe it sort of butts up against things like GPS and global positioning. And so I think, for example, like the Defense Department wasn't happy about it, but, just the potential for, opening up this huge new area of spectrum to unlicensed use, I guess the FCC decided it was worth it. So
who's going to be able to use that new band? So previously the available bands were 2.4 and 5 gigahertz, right?
Yes.
So who is going to be able to now use the 6 gigahertz band? Is it any provider? Is that what makes it sort of unlicensed?
Yeah, it's there for Wi-Fi. So anybody who makes, you can make a router that will, label it Wi-Fi 6E, and if it has the right radios and everything and it's up to standard, it will be able to use those new frequencies.
So let's think a little bit now about consumers. Okay, great. They now have their Wi-Fi 6 enabled iPhone 11 and they have a Wi-Fi 6 router at home and it's great. It's awesome. They can connect, tons of iPhone 11s to their Wi-Fi 6 router, but can they connect to this Wi-Fi 6E?
No, not yet. You're going to need, that's going to require it's going to require new kinds of radios and everything, in access points and in endpoints. From what I'm hearing, I believe we'll probably see, sort of first generation, possibly even pre-standard Wi-Fi 6E access points hit the market, maybe in time for the holidays this year, which is already pretty quick in the grand scheme of things. And then we'll start seeing endpoints and then probably, more enterprise focus access points, early-ish next year, I would say.
So obviously before any of this happens, device makers need to make the actual router devices, clients or other sort of like user devices, laptops, phones, maybe IoT devices need to be created. But let's talk first about the standards. Just because it's unlicensed doesn't really mean it's going to be a free-for-all, right?
No, the IEEE is the group that, sort of handles all the standard making for this. And they move at their own pace and, there are a ton of industry stakeholders in there. So it's, at least partially driven by the industry itself. But sometimes you'll get, companies with their, if they're particularly confident that, they can make some, a piece of equipment that's going to be compatible with, the eventual official Wi-Fi 6E standard, they'll make it, sell it as Wi-Fi 6E, even since that is technically still a marketing term. I believe they still use the 802.11 whatever officially. But yeah, so you'll get pre-standard gear like that in some points.
All right, so before I let you go, John, I think I just want to sort of, you know, set our viewers' expectations in order. So if they are looking to deploy, you know, once all of their employees are back into the office and they work in the IT department, can they deploy Wi-Fi 6 now? What sort of devices do their employees need? And then I also want to think a little bit about Wi-Fi 6, when and what is the benefit for some types of enterprises to use either or?
I think broadly everyone's going to want to upgrade to Wi-Fi 6 at some point. It just, a lot of it's going to depend on what your upgrade cycle looks like, which in turn will depend on what industry you're in, you know, any number of variables specific to your business itself. So that's, you know, I'm sorry not to be more specific, but the upshot is that everyone's going to want it eventually. You know, every endpoint is eventually going to have it. It's just, you know, it's going to be the new standard, and it's already started to happen, frankly. So,
and just one more thing that I'm curious about, since this now 6 gigahertz band is going to be unlicensed, how will some companies or departments, agencies who have been operating now on this 6 gigahertz band, how are they going to be dealing with any potential interference? Is there a potential for interference?
The answer to that depends largely who you ask. The wireless industry says, of course not. There are many safeguards built into the standard. There's no potential for interference at all. The current stakeholders who are in there say, well, actually, no, there's a lot of potential still for interference, but to be honest, it's tough to tell. You know, analysts I've spoken to seem to think that the potential for, you know, seriously impacting something like GPS is fairly remote, but, you know, again, there's a lot of back and forth about that still.
Well, thank you so much, John, for calling in and talking Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 6E. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
And thank you all so much for watching this episode of Today in Tech. If you liked this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel. If you have any questions about Wi-Fi 6 or Wi-Fi 6E or even Wi-Fi 5, please leave a comment below and I'll get back to you on John's behalf. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time.